This week on ANN, a new Adventist hymnal in Portuguese has 600 songs, 238 of which by Brazilian authors. The Adventist Church celebrates hundreds of baptisms in Mexico. And brothers volunteer to teach music in a project supported by Federation of Entrepreneurs. These stories and more coming up. Thank you so much for joining us this week. First in the news, after almost 4 years of work, the committee responsible for the new Adventist hymnal in Portuguese announced the launch date set for July 8. The hymnal was redesigned and rearranged to give greater prominence to the doctrinal identity of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. As a result, 230 hymns were removed, and in their place, 220 hymns not previously part of the repertoire were included. In order to reach a larger group of members, especially children and young people, changes were made to make the language more simple and easy to understand.
A música faz parte do culto a Deus nas cortes celestiais. E devemos esforçar-nos por nos aproximar tanto quanto possível da harmonia dos coros celestiais. Legado centenário. Para músicas inesquecíveis, consagração. Para sons celestiais, inspiração. Para adoração sincera, entrega. Para louvar a Deus, novo hinário adventista.
Thousands of Seventh-day Adventists in Baja California, Mexico gathered to celebrate the end of evangelism efforts which began earlier this year and resulted in 700 new believers joining the church. Leaders and active church members took part in a Sabbath worship program where government, national, and international church leaders spoke and witnessed the work of the church and the baptism of 230 persons. According to Evangelism Director for the Adventist Church in Baja California, Cedric Arena, the celebration came after a full week of 116 evangelists from several parts of Mexico and abroad, working hand in hand with local churches to take part in evangelistic campaigns. From Mexico, we go to Orlando, Florida in the United States to find out what AdventHealth continues to do for the Ukrainian people.
Our efforts to help the people of Ukraine continue. We recently caught up with an AdventHealth University educator who traveled to the war-torn country with his wife to personally deliver much-needed medical supplies. Here again, videographer David Maddox with their story.
Since the disaster started in Ukraine, AdventHealth has really tried to respond and help.
You are ready for me. Thank you so much.
We recently had two people from the Orlando area.
These are the pictures of children in the orphanage.
Julia Kostyuk, as well as her husband, Dr. Oleg Kostyuk, who's a professor at AdventHealth University. We're able to travel to the Ukraine and meet with the clinic that we work with over there and take some desperately needed medications.
Do you have some? This is all
this it? Is all suture.
My wife, who is a family nurse practitioner, she was instrumental in connecting with the clinic in Ukraine and also collecting all needed supplies here.
I'll take it. Maybe they'll need it. Before I went, I think the biggest difference, before I went on the trip, I was hurting inside.
When we got to Ukraine, we saw a very many displaced people who were forced to leave their homes. We brought seven huge and heavy suitcases.
being able to actually take these medications and give them to the doctors, it's hard to describe in words. When they got it, they had tears in their eyes. They said, this insulin will help save lives.
Even though the tragedy of war seems distant, we still can make a difference. And to me, this is just such a direct image of our mission of extending the healing ministry of Christ.
It was a life-transforming trip. The joy that your heart is filled with is tremendous. It doesn't matter whether you're in Ukraine or Florida, we all can make a difference.
And that is just one of the efforts our team members are part of to help the people of Ukraine across the CFD. Our Picture of the Week segment takes us to AdventHealth Celebration. This is what it looked like recently when team members there worked together to pack meals to help feed Ukrainian refugees. The goal going in was for them to put together an incredible 100,000 individual meals, but guess what? They went a little over that. Okay, they went a lot over that. When all was said and done, there were 200,000 meals packed and ready to send overseas. Wow, this one truly demonstrates all of our service standards. In Orlando, Tom Johnson for AdventHealth.
In a music project supported by the Federation of Adventist Entrepreneurs of Brazil, five brothers used their time and talent to make a difference. These internationally renowned musicians are dedicating their time to help transform the lives of children through music.
40 children have the opportunity to learn music for free. Violin and ukulele lessons take place at the headquarters of Casa Esperança, or Hope House, a ministry that serves needy families in the central region of Rio de Janeiro with baths, haircuts, medical care, Bible studies, and also functions as an Adventist church. The Música Esperança, or Hope Music Project, began through the initiative of musician and teacher Gabby Antunes, after attending Pastor Jonas Pinho's sermon at the Adventist Church in Barra, Rio de Janeiro, about Hope House. On the same day, Gabby got in touch with the ministry coordinators, and the next day, she bought 40 violins and 20 ukuleles. The geographic distance did not stop teacher Gabby, who lives in New Mexico in the United States, from teaching ukulele and applied music with math and other skills online. She confesses that her purpose is to help children to get to know Jesus through music. It's a way of honoring the memory of her father, who was a musician, and her mother. The Hope Music Project serves children and teenagers ages 6 to 14 years old, who also get lunch and snacks on site.
This life-changing project continues to reach many lives as it expands, and soon children will be able to receive music lessons for other instruments as well. Gabby, the music instructor, has a plan to ultimately create an orchestra that will play songs for the glory of God. Coming up, dentists that are offering free dental care and sharing the love of Jesus in Africa. And after that, we'll hear a report on a camp meeting that took place in the U.S. state of Michigan.
No matter what. Pray all the time. Thank God no matter what happens. This is the way God wants you who belong to Christ Jesus to live.
There are more than 8,000 registered dentists in Africa, serving an approximate population of 1 billion and 200 million people. That is a dentist-to-population ratio of 1 for every 150,000. These numbers show how challenging it is for people on this continent to achieve dental health. For that reason, Riverside Farm Institute, along with International Caring Hands, is providing free dental care and sharing Jesus' love to thousands of people every year.
So here in Zambia, their minimum wage is 40 kwacha, and that's $2. And if they want a dental procedure, they have to pay 100 kwacha, which is $5 for just one tooth extraction. And I believe here, especially here in the southern province, I was told that there is not a dentist at all.
So there are times that there's so many people who come, and like we cannot serve all of them, so we need to turn them down. And you know, like as a dentist, we know we have talent, we know we have these skills, but we're not able to serve them at that time. And then also we know that they come from far places, but we need to turn them down because it's just too much.
So we were able to partner with International Caring Hands when we saw that need for dental work. And they were able to come in, put in a mobile truck-based clinic, and people were really amazed. You know, you just pull up into this box truck, you got two full dental stations, they added x-ray, suction, you know, all the normal things you would expect in a Western style dental service care.
There are some people that will come here and we'll have a really long line of people and they'll be like, I walked 6 hours to get here. So it's really awesome to like go out into the villages and like people who didn't even know that dental care was an option has never heard of us.
They have a Land Rover that's in place. And we said, how can we use that to reach more people? And so we've outfitted it with a battery system, with a special air compression system to allow you to literally go to any village under any mango tree where people have never seen dental care in you know, existence of the humankind. And so with that, this country is, even though it's in Africa, has a lot of water. It's large bodies of water. One of the things we would love to see happen is to get a catamaran-style boat with a full surgical center anywhere in the country where there's water. Where you can't go with the Land Cruisers or the Land Rover, you can go with the boat and take medical teams fully outfitted to do the care that people aren't getting somewhere else.
So in Zambia, the needs in dental treatment, I would say, it's about prevention and dental education. Because here, mostly, even though the dental clinic is there, even though it's free, patients only come when it's like too paining or already badly broken.
It's not really something that they'll think about. And just to be able to like take that burden off of their life, take them out of pain, I think is a really big goal and it's important. And then just like show them Jesus's love, because the dentists here, they could be getting paid so much to work in a first world country and deal with easy cases and all that, but they've chosen to be here and dedicate their time to giving free dental care to people who really need it.
Before, when I was still a dental student, my real goal is just to get money.
In dentistry, you can just go straight. The path is like so clear. You just work, and you're happy.
But to see them, to see all their needs, is life changing. Once you do and serve other people, you stop looking at yourself, and you just see that even though you have little to give, that can mean the world to them. And a lot of times I would question myself, like, Lord, I don't have enough skills. I would rather have training. What if I cannot manage this case or that? But just to see that I can, even the small that I can give, can mean the world and can be a life-changing moment for them.
There's this one patient, I pray with her. I pray and I open my eyes. She was like in tears. And then she said like, this is what I really need today.
what it's made me realize more than anything is that you're capable of way more than you think you are. It's just an awesome experience, and you just have a new perspective on life and on the world. I just think that it's really cool to get those experiences that you wouldn't be able to have anywhere else.
Maybe working as a dentist, it's kind of just like monotonous, but if you want to experience something beyond of just like dentistry.
I would say that this experience will be very helping for you. Not even just for the time that you'll be here and you'll feel great about helping people, but it will also change the whole view that you will have in your practice or in life.
So the overall goal of the ministry that we're doing here is, of course, to bring healing to the people, to alleviate their pain, to bring more smiles to them. And we use this ministry first and foremost as a wedge so that we can introduce Jesus to them and that they will know that someone cares for them and loves them so much.
Christian camps provide us with special moments to be in touch with God, with friends, and with nature. All this and much more happened at the Michigan Conference Camp Meeting 2022.
The Michigan Adventist Camp Meeting took place June 10th through the 18th at the Great Lakes Adventist Academy in Cedar Lake, Michigan. Each day's activities started early as pastoral and staff teams met together to seek God's wisdom through study of His Word and prayer. The young ones attended their age-appropriate events, which included Bible studies, praise, worship, crafts, and recreational activities. The adults were provided the opportunity to attend over 30 seminars, sharing God's word, His grace, and His love for mankind.
We always enjoy Michigan Camp Meeting because of its emphasis on family ministries.
Yes.
I don't know of any other place where you can come and you can hear about your marriage, your relationships, your children.
It's so good to actually even just connect with other people who are in the same stages that you are. Every age group is represented here, as far as if you have teenagers, if you have a little newborn baby, toddlers, you name it.
At the end of each day, the adults assembled together in one accord, listening to the wonderful speakers while thanking God for the day.
We're so thankful for heaven's blessing as the Lord draws His people from all over the state of Michigan and far beyond. We have over 1,800 members, men, women, boys, and girls, staying right here on campus. And then on Sabbath, the numbers can swell well over 3,500 people. And that's not even counting the hundreds and hundreds that join us by live stream, I believe in more than 33 countries around the world. And so we're just so grateful for the way the Lord draws us together as His people from near and far to come and join in this camp meeting experience.
Our theme this year was Knowing the Time. We know that Jesus is coming. And so all of our seminars, all of our main speaking appointments, all of those things were centered around that particular topic, preparing to meet Jesus face to face and helping us to, and equipping us so that we can help others to do that same thing.
Coming up, let's get to know the story of a 12-year-old boy who wanted to be a missionary in Bolivia. And in Adventist history, we will know a little of William Henry Wakeham's life, a Canadian missionary who served in the United States, Egypt, and was head of the Bible Department at Emmanuel Missionary College, today's Andrews University.
Smoking, diabetes, and obesity may shrink your brain. As if there weren't already enough good reasons to avoid smoking and keep your weight, blood sugar levels, and blood pressure all under control, a new study from the University of California found that these risk factors in middle age were linked to potentially dangerous vascular changes in your brain, leading to faster drop in brain volume and declines in function up to a decade later. That's a fact. But there's hope. This study adds to the evidence that good living preserves mental abilities, and that there are things we can do in middle age that can have effects 10, 20, and 30 years down the road to improve cognitive health. So don't wait. Walk, drink more water, and improve your diet. A healthy retirement starts today.
Why is there evil in the world? Are Christians hypocrites? Is the Bible a fairy tale? Does Jesus love everyone? Church doesn't feel relevant to my life. Is God even real? You have questions? Let's talk about it. I Believe Bible.
Welcome back. Ariel liked the idea of being a missionary, but what could a little boy in Bolivia do? Despite the circumstances, he believed in God, prayed, and asked. Ariel had a willing attitude, and God blessed it. Adventist Mission has more.
One Sabbath, 12-year-old Ariel heard a sermon that really made him think. The pastor had said that everyone should be involved in missionary work. Ariel liked the idea of being a missionary, but what could a 12-year-old boy in Bolivia do? Ariel began to pray and ask God to help him be a missionary. He began to look for people who might be interested in learning about Jesus. As he looked, he kept praying. He didn't have to look far. One day, he went with his parents and sister to visit another family. While there, he learned that the family was interested in the Bible. He offered to give them Bible studies, and they agreed. Ariel had never given Bible studies before, so he wasn't really sure what to do, but he found a set of Bible lessons and studied them with the family. It wasn't easy, especially the last few lessons, but he prayed for God to help him. Ariel wanted to give more Bible studies, so he invited his classmate, Eber, to study the Bible with him. Eber looked forward to each new lesson. When they finished studying, Eber decided to give his life to Jesus and was baptized. Ariel was so happy. God was helping him be a missionary. He remembered his original prayer to be a missionary and decided to continue praying to see what God wanted from him next. Ariel has found that he can be a missionary in many ways. He studies the Sabbath school lesson every day so he can learn more about God. Whenever he earns some money, he sets aside 10% to return to God as tithe. And he also gladly gives some of the money as an offering. In everything that Ariel does, he wants to put God first. Even though Ariel is only 12, he has already led others to Jesus. No one is ever too young to be a missionary, he says. We can all be missionaries, sharing our love for God as we wait for him to take us to heaven. There is no Adventist church where Ariel lives. His family and others meet in one another's homes on Sabbath. It was in one of the church members' homes that Ariel heard the sermon that inspired him to become a missionary. Ariel's dream is for a church to open in his town one day. Part of this quarter's 13 Sabbath offering will help open a church near Ariel's town. Thank you for planning a generous offering so that more people can have a church where they can gather and share the good news that Jesus is coming soon.
Watch this and other mission stories online by visiting AdventistMission.org, then click on Videos at the top. And finally on today's episode, let's turn to Ashley Chisholm for a look at Adventist history.
Welcome to This Week in Adventist History. On July 5, 1905, William Henry Wakeham sailed from New York headed for Europe with plans to attend meetings at Friedensau in Germany and then return to his field of labor in Egypt. Wakeham was born in London, Ontario, Canada on September 21, 1858, and at some point his family moved to the U.S. state of Iowa. As a teenager, Wakeham became a Seventh-day Adventist as well as an educator. In 1883, he married Emma L. Ray, and 2 years later, worked as a tent master for Arthur G. Daniels. In 1889, he became a Bible teacher at the Battle Creek Sanitarium, and in 1890, he was elected as field secretary of the American Health and Temperance Association, a work he was active in for 5 years. In 1895, Wakeham took the position of Bible teacher at Mount Vernon Academy in Ohio and worked there until he was called to take charge of the Egyptian mission in 1903. In 1907, Emma's health declined, and so the Wakehams set sail for England. Sadly, Emma died en route, leaving William a widower with 4 children, though their youngest was a teenager at the time. He commented in the obituary he wrote for her, "Our loss, Egypt's loss, but we trust God to make it plain." After losing Emma, William remained for a time in England and married Mabel Pringle in 1910. Together, they had 3 children. In 1913, the Wakehams returned to the United States, where William became the head of the Bible department at Emmanuel Missionary College, today's Andrews University. He stayed in that department until 1935, when he retired at age 76. He passed away on November 16, 1946. His story comes from This Week in Adventist History.
Thanks for watching ANN. Join us next week for more news from the headquarters of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Did you know the Adventist Church has a YouTube channel where you can watch ANN Video, ANN In Depth, and plenty of other amazing videos on prophecy, health, and Bible study? Just go to YouTube and search for the Adventist Church. Make sure you click on the subscribe button to make sure you're caught up each week. And remember, leave a comment or a prayer request. We have people who are praying for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Before we say goodbye, here's some good news from the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. The passage says, "Therefore, whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." That's our program for this week. And remember, you can always visit Adventist.news for daily news and videos. Until next time, God bless.